Today's message is found in Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37, the story of the Good Samaritan. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What is your reading of it?" And so he answered and said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have answered rightly. Do this, and you will live." But he, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Then Jesus answered and said, "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him, bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you.' So which of these three do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And the lawyer said, he who showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. This passage starts with a lawyer standing up and questioning Jesus, asking him how to inherit eternal life. He's not a lawyer like an attorney, but a lawyer educated in Jewish law and exercising the word. He presented this question to Jesus in the hopes he would trap him in some way. He was looking for an opportunity to persecute him. He presented this question to Jesus in the hopes that he would trap him in some way. He was looking for an opportunity to persecute him. At the time, this lawyer would have been challenging Jesus' credentials as the Son of God. Now, for someone in there, in a right place in their heart, this is the right question, and Jesus is absolutely the right person to ask. But that wasn't the lawyer's intentions. The lawyer asked Jesus in chapter 25, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus responded in chapter 26 by asking the lawyer, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? Knowing that this lawyer would know the right answer. The lawyer responded, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. It's a perfect answer. Jesus says to him, you have answered rightly. Do this, and you will live. The lawyer, being educated in Jewish law, was referencing the Old Testament, a summation of God's law, requiring a perfect love for God and mankind. Jesus said, do this, and you will live. Not satisfied with that answer, the lawyer asks, and who is my neighbor? He's asking Jesus to define his neighbor. He's going back again to Old Testament language regarding loving who God loves, hating who God hates, loathing those things God loathes. During these times, the Pharisees and scribes were like groups that stuck together and considered themselves righteous in God's eyes and separate from others. He's asking Jesus to help him sort out who he is to love and who he is to hate. An enemy of God is the lawyer's enemy. But Jesus has said, love your enemies and love the stranger in your midst. The lawyer is challenging Jesus for saying your enemies and strangers are reclassified as your neighbor. This passage is designed to crush the self-righteous, shatter the prideful, and the self-justifying. So what does the law require? It's to be kind. In the beginning of the parable, the priest in the story is supposed to be the beacon of hope, but he shuns the beaten man, not only turns away from him, but goes to the other side of the road to maintain a distance from him. The priest is not obeying the law of God. He has shown zero love for the beaten man. In studying this passage, I've heard people say maybe the priest was on his way to the temple and concerned about being unclean if he had touched him, or maybe the robbers were still present and he was worried that they might get him too, or maybe this person was deserving of the beating. Maybe this was the wrath of God that he had received and he didn't want to get in the way. But the truth is, it's a story. It's a parable. Jesus made it up. Those details, they weren't included or even entertained because that takes away from the point. The point is, it's a priest who loves God and their fellow man. He should have stopped, should have shown compassion and got involved in some way, but he didn't. Then a Levite comes down the road. He also passes the man by. A Levite is an assistant to the priest. Levites were often the hands and feet of the temple, maintaining the property and managing the mechanics of the temple. Surely he would have helped. Nope. He failed to help as well. Neither have earned or will inherit eternal life. The lawyer at this point is blown away. Who will help this man? Now that the keepers of the law have been indicted and failed. And then along comes a Samaritan. Now a Samaritan was defined as evil. They had intermarried with Gentiles, disturbing the rebuilding of the temple, and in 128 BC had attacked the temple. To be referred to as a Samaritan was an insult. In fact, there was no greater insult than to be called a demon-possessed Samaritan. Samaritans had no access to the temple, no access to the priest, and no access to God. But it was the Samaritan that did the right thing. The godly didn't do anything. They did not meet the requirements for eternal life, but our Samaritan did. Samaritan takes center stage in the story and shows the way. He stopped. He cared for him. He bandaged his wounds, probably tore shards of his garments to make bandages. He clothed them from his back. He pours oil and wine to soothe and treat his wounds. He put him on his animal, most likely a donkey, and then walked beside him. Takes him to an inn. Now, an inn, this is not the Holiday Inn, by the way. This would have been a roadside place, a first available, a rough type of place. You'd only go in the event of an emergency. And he stayed with him all night. And we know that because Jesus said the next day he pays the innkeeper. He pays the innkeeper 2 denarii. And as a reference, archaeologists have actually found a sign, a wooden sign from that time period, that had on it what a rate would be for an inn for the night. And what they found was it was the equivalent of 1/32nd of a denarii per night. So if you do the math, the Samaritan had prepaid roughly for a 2-month stay. He instructed the innkeeper to care for the man and to give him whatever he needs, giving the man lavish attention. He also tells the innkeeper that if the man uses more than a 2 denarii, then he will pay more when he returns. It's significant because the Samaritan is putting himself at risk of being taken advantage of or even extortion. But he is showing this man lavish love. All of this being done by a Samaritan, an enemy to the righteous. The Samaritan has loved his neighbor as himself. He has provided the love, care, and compassion he would have shown himself. The same you and I would if we found ourselves beaten and robbed. I mean, who does this? Being able to say that maybe we've done that once or twice or maybe even 10 times in our life is great, but it's not enough. We need to be the hero in this story always. Love with no limits. This is the way to eternal life. We are commanded to love perfectly all the time. Love others as we love ourselves. Care for others as we would care for ourselves. In chapter 36, Jesus asked the lawyer, "Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to him who fell among the thieves?" Notice the question. Jesus has flipped the script on the lawyer again. The lawyer had asked who my neighbor is, and Jesus asked him who is the better neighbor. It's about loving your neighbor by being a good neighbor. Knowing your neighbors are everyone who comes into your path, seeing their needs and fulfilling them. Your enemies and strangers to you are your neighbors. In chapter 37, the lawyer answers Jesus and says, "He who showed mercy on him." Jesus then says to him, "Go and do likewise." The lawyer, as with all of us, was able to realize that we're not capable of this level of love 100% of the time. We're going to need forgiveness, mercy, and grace. Our shortcomings are made whole through him. Be perfect or rely on Jesus. Jesus is saying, do like the Samaritan always, and eternal life is yours. But we know it's not man's nature to do so. We're going to need to admit our sins and inability. Through Jesus is eternal life. We're unable to earn our way there or follow a checklist of acts. We're unable to love perfectly like God. The lawyer's question was bogus, really. The short answer would have been, through me. But Jesus never passed up a chance to reach into the hearts of man and teach perfect love. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and for this message. We ask for wisdom to identify the fallen and the hurt and the strength to help. We ask for your forgiveness and mercy for the times we have turned a blind eye to those in need. Open our eyes to our neighbors and our hearts to their needs. In your Son's precious name, amen.